So, hello everyone, welcome to Python Pune Meetup. In today's virtual talk, we are going to discuss about life of CVE, which is introduction to CVE and vulnerability databases. So, this is a little about myself. My name is Yadnevil Kittali. I'm security and open source enthusiast, and I work at Red Hat. So let's begin. So due to recent breaches and security threats, security is very interesting topic nowadays. So you must be reading security news like this from Hacker News or any other tech site, which are about how and which product got security issue or have recent security incidences. So have you ever wondered what this CVE is? So to understand CVE, you must understand what are the flaws and vulnerabilities. So software engineering definition says weaknesses or problems of the software are the flaws. So what are the security flaws then? So security flaws are a security weaknesses of the software. In other words, security flaws are the implementation defects which can lead to vulnerabilities. And the vulnerability is exploitable condition of the code that allow attacker to harm availability, integrity, or confidentiality of the system. So flaws and vulnerability are two easiest sides of defects to mix up. So many times researcher or people just confuse between those. And just because a flaw is not a vulnerability at the present moment, it doesn't mean it cannot be, it cannot become basically in future. For example, let's assume I'm running Python on my system with request module, and request module has some vulnerability. Now I'm not using request module in my code, hence, there is a flaw, but I am not vulnerable. But what if new intern join my team and start coding into a request module? So in that case, a vulnerable request module code is in my products, right? So I'm vulnerable and there is a vulnerability. So it's all depends on conditions, environments and architecture and tons of other things. So sometimes this also happens. And in simple words, once someone has figured out a way to attack flaw, the flaw become vulnerability. So anytime you get confused with flaw and vulnerability, just think it like all vulnerabilities are the flaws, but not all flaws are the vulnerabilities. Common weakness, this is the common weakness enumeration or CWE, which is one of the guidance we can use to refer mapping between flaws and vulnerabilities. So CWE provides baseline standard for different classes of weaknesses. So we have, let's see on slide. So you have first CWE 119, which is basically a memory buffer vulnerabilities. And there are like more than 12,000 vulnerabilities of memory buffers, which includes buffer overflows, use of free, and all buffer related vulnerabilities. And on second number, there are popular web application vulnerability that is cross-site scripting. So their CWE number is 79, which is top. And there are 11,000 plus vulnerabilities are there. So you can go to this link and check stats for more of the info. So we have context now. So what is a CVE? So CVE started in 1999, and CVE stands for Common Vulnerability and Exposures. So CVE is a dictionary that provides definition for publicly disclosed cybersecurity vulnerabilities and exposures. And it is basically a definition, and goal here is to make it easier to share data across separate tools, databases, and services. So isn't CVE just another vulnerability database? Actually, no. CVE is not a vulnerability database, and rather it is designed to allow vulnerability databases and other capability to be linked together. So if you have used Grafana or OpenSCAP, it used as a monitoring and alerting system, and CVE plays a vital role in that. So so we can check if we are vulnerable to particular CVE. So earlier, before CVEs, company used to write blogs related to security fixes and announcements, and they were those blogs were hard to track and hard to collaborate between other distributions and softwares. So that was barely possible before CVEs. So CVE is, in other words, are something other than we fix something described in second paragraph on the web page under the over there. And even that web page goes down, it doesn't matter, because we are tracking those as a CVE IDs. But what exactly the CVE is? So we saw standard definition of CVE, but CVE structure is looks like this. So CVE is a string that everyone can put into their security bulletin, their security blocks, and it has format or schema like shown in slide. So it has this keyword, CVE, followed by a year and unique identifier. For example, a CVE 1999-0001. So this was the first CVE which MITRE released in 1999. So if you find some string like this, you will now know it is a latest or old CVE simply. So this is about the identifiers. And CVE entry consists of this three things: a unique ID, this description of vulnerability, and at least one public reference. So unique ID will tell you time frame of CVE, where description will tell you what CVE is all about, and the reference to use as a technical information of the flaw. So you'll find CVE description more or less in this format. You will have problem type, which is in particular product or a version, which causes following impact when certain condition is triggered or attack is made. For example, let's say denial of service at flaw was found in FFmpeg 2.3 library, which causes system crash when attacker loop back with node flag. So here, denial of service DOS vulnerability is problem type. FFmpeg 2.3 is product and version. It is causing impact like a system crash, and it is due to that condition of node flag. So this is as simple as that. So about description of CVE, we have someone here in talk who is expert of writing CVEs, and it's writing CVE description basically. And honestly, it is not an easy task as it looks. So they are responsible to make vulnerability clear to stakeholders without disclosing any technical information. There are people who can reverse engineering process and find vulnerability. So it is very, very important how you write description of the CVE. So this is how CVE on MITRE's MITRE side looks like. So this is CVE ID, this is description, and there are few references. Okay. So who owns this CVE? So MITRE Corporation has all copyright of the CVE list, and they handle CV program basically. So to be clear, MyTrade do not have acronym. It is a complete word, and many Hindi speakers call it Mitre. Even I call it Mitre, but Mitre is not a correct pronunciation. It's MITRE. So this program is sponsored by U.S. Department of Homeland Security and other security government agencies. But MITRE is not one who can assign CVs. So we have CV numbering authorities who can assign CVs. So CNA are organizations around the world which are responsible to assign CVID to vulnerabilities which are basically affecting products within their distinct or agreed upon scope. And they are also responsible to make first time public announcement of new vulnerabilities. For example, Red Hat or Debian assign CVs for kernel, and Cisco assign for networking components like routers, switches, and it works like this. So let talks about structure of CNA a little bit. So there are three types of CNA: program root CNA, root CNA, and CNA or sub CNA we call them. A program root CNA is responsible to allocate CV pools to root CNAs and sub CNAs, and they oversees the CNA program. Whereas root CNA manages a group of sub CNA within community or distinct unit, so they can also assign CVs. And then it comes CNA or sub CNA, who analyze the flaw and assign CV. So for example, a MITRE is program root CNA, a MITRE, as we call them, is a program root CNA, and it is also a root CNA. And vendors like Red Hat, Apple, Cisco are sub CNAs. So this CNA structuring helps to work efficiently and faster than ever. So this is a diagram how this works. So although there are only two root CNAs at the moment, so there is primary CNA, which is MITRE, and then root CNA. So there are currently two root CNAs, MITRE and Japan CERT, and there are sub CNAs under them, which are something like Red Hat, Debian, and all. So So let's see how this works. So reporter find a security vulnerability, and he sends a report to CNA saying, I found some vulnerability in this product and I want a CV. And if CNA finds that report a CV worthy, they can send that back to a CVID. They can send back that CVID to the reporter within a fixed time frame. So there is no fixed time frame for this. Every other CNA has their own guidelines on the on how the CNA works. So CNA. So these are all list of CNAs. There are 128 organizations who can assign CNA. There are two popular bug bounty programs. First is HackerOne, and second is Internet Security Consortium, who can assign CVs. There are vulnerability researchers. So researchers are not a singular person. They are currently, the organization only. And there are vendors and projects like Red Hat, Fedora projects, or Debian. So they can also assign the CVs. So where the CVs are getting listed, right? So they get listed on vulnerability databases. So vulnerability databases are platform which aim at collecting and maintaining or reanalyzing information about discovered computer security vulnerabilities. So they are mostly searchable databases which access and score how critical vulnerability is. And if there are mitigations or workaround to the issue, they can list that onto their page. So there are more than 20 vulnerabilities databases exist now, and few of them, few important of them are National Vulnerability Database, NVDI. There is also Chinese National Vulnerability Database. So from National Vulnerability Database, you can quickly know National stands for US National Vulnerability Database. But the second, Chinese National Vulnerability Database are similar to NVDI, just they don't update it very quickly. They are very slow. And other types of databases are Red Hat CVE database, which is basically CNA database, and Microsoft Security Bulletin, which is also a database. And GitHub recently started a security advising database. So if you are not able to request a CVE to root CNA, you can also request CVE to GitHub, and they can publish advisories. So out of all of this vulnerability databases, the National Vulnerability Database is important to discuss. So a National Vulnerability Database is a US government's repository of vulnerabilities. And it is also a searchable database, which handles by National Institute of Standard, NIST. So NVDI is primary database for MITRE CVE list. So CVEs, you can find CVEs in NVDI. So basically NVDI has more search capabilities, and NVDI and CVEs are synchronized. So everyone can make use of this databases and information. And this is the NVDI link. Let me show you how this looks like. So this is the National Vulnerability Database website. You can find this vulnerability CVE ID. You can find its score, if privilege is required, user interaction is required, it is medium severity vulnerability, what are the references, and what are the CW type. So very similar to NVDI, Red Hat, who is CNA, also has its own CVE database. So where Red Hat also access and score vulnerabilities. So this is all about vulnerability databases. What if I got a security flaw where I should request a CVE? If that component is widely used, it is always worth to get a CVE. You need to check component is from CNA. If it is from CNA, then you need to request CVE to CNA, CVE naming authority. And if component is not from CNA, you can always request a CVE to root CNA. For example, if you found a flaw in basically firewall D, it is maintained by Red Hat, so you will request a CVE to Red Hat. But if you found vulnerability in jQuery or JavaScript library, so Node.js is also CNA, but you can also ask CNA to root CNAs, that is MITRE. I always often ask MITRE for jQuery vulnerabilities, jQuery CVEs, because they are fast, faster than Node.js CVE authorities. That is what I experienced so far. So this is how we do it. And when it comes to requesting it to CNA, there is form asking information about issue, and you can fill this form, and MITRE will assign ID if it is CVE worthy. So let me show you the form. So you can always make use of this link. I can share this slide after this presentation. So on this form, if you select request a CVE, you can find email address, and then you have option to add GPG key there, and vendor type, vendor products and all of the information. So you can put technical information here, and then MITRE assess if it is CVE worthy, and they will assign it CVE. But what if you know CNA? So you should check their website for security contact, and if there are some guidelines. And do not Google this, because this is very easy to spoof. If CNA do not have SPF record or their email record is expired, for example. And always prefer encrypted mail if you are providing technical information or regular emails. So here are a few sub CNA contacts. There are like Red Hat Fedora projects. So if you found a flaw in Red Hat or Fedora project, you can send it to secalet@redhat.com. There is Debian, and there is Apple security contacts. So you often find security contacts starts with security@redhat some email address. So it is good to know. So I think we are near to this talk, and this is time to share a story. So can you get a CVE for a fake vulnerability? Sadly, yes, you can. And often it is possible. So security researchers and organizations often get a credit for finding a security vulnerability. So they put fake information for that credits, and they put it into their resumes, websites. So then often they do it, this unethical thing, to just get credit, though I won't recommend you to do this thing. So I got such issue last month. So there was a report from jQuery. So this is jQuery 2.2 vulnerability, and they reported jQuery 2.2 allows accesses via crafted on-air attribute of the IMG element. So if you know, IMG tag of HTML has this on-error attribute, and we put any function there, so when image gets loaded, that JavaScript function get executed. So reporter claims that it is a security issue, and MITRE also accepted that case and assigned it CVE. But if you know, this is not a bug and rather a feature, because on error attribute is meant to execute the JavaScript function. So this was spam entry actually. And then we contacted jQuery Foundation and MITRE, and they added this disputed label. So these things also happen. So we need to very carefully. If you go to this link, you can see this disputed label. And reporter also provided a nice and good POC like this, but this was all fake. Okay. So a quick recap. So we saw what are the security vulnerabilities are, and what are the flaws are, what is the CWE and common weakness enumeration, and what is CVE, basically a common vulnerability exposure, and what are their structure is, what are their how the CVEs work, and there are CNAs which are CVE numbering authorities like MITRE, Red Hat, Apple, etc. And there are vulnerability databases like NVD and the Chinese vulnerability, national vulnerability databases. And we also saw how to request CVE through CNA and root CNAs. So if you go to this link, this is how Red Hat this is how Red Hat publishes or announces CVEs. So there is CVE ID, it is public date. So this is moderate impact. So Red Hat basically assess a score of CVE. So on scale of 10, it is 6 point. It is rated 6.5. So it is medium severity, moderate severity CVE. So this is a description of CVE, and this is a table which show you which components of Red Hats are affected. Like CloudForms is affected, which has package 5.9, and what is resolution of, after that. So analyst made it conclusion that we are not fixing 5.9 flaws, and 5.10 also affected, and 5.8 is out of scope. So they also assess this with scoring, so you can find attack vector, attack complexity, and all these things. And Red Hat also acknowledge reporter. So I think this name is very familiar to me. He must be a good security researcher. Just kidding, that's my CVE. So this was shameless plug. So that's my rant. I think I made it quick. So thank you. Vishal?
Thank you, Yadav. That was a great talk. Like, I was never aware about the CNA and other stuffs. I just had a query. Let's say in my project, I'm going to use PHP version 5.5, let's say. So before using it into production, how can I check, like, is there any vulnerability which is infecting that version of PHP? And so where is the best place to look out for? I don't know if this question is right, just it came into my mind.
Right. So this is a very good question. So if you have a PHP and you want to know if it is affected, so there are a few open source vulnerability scanners. So if you know about OpenScap, it is also vulnerability. I mean, it can also show you vulnerability if you are, your PHP is affected by vulnerability. But in that case, you need to install that PHP first. But before installing, if you want to know what are the vulnerabilities are, I mean, related to the PHP, your PHP version, you can also refer vulnerability database. You can go to CVE list, that is MITRE CVE list. That's thing.
Okay.
Exactly, this thing. And you can you can search your PHP and PHP version, and you will get all the list of CVEs, related to that vulnerable PHP version. So, apart from this, if you want to just scan and get a number of CVEs attached to that, I mean, affected to that PHP version, there are open source scanner available, but I won't recommend you to use that. I mean, manual checking is always better. So this also can help.
Okay. Yeah, great. So it was a wonderful talk, and I would request users, if they have any queries, they can post it onto the chat and we can connect with Yadnya meanwhile. So Akshay has some query. So Akshay, you can go ahead.
Hi, Vatale. That was a good talk. I just have a curious to know about zero-day vulnerabilities, what they mean actually. And if you can talk about it.
Sure. So zero-day vulnerabilities are, zero-day vulnerabilities are unknown flaws, which gets published or announced. And developers or maintainer of that component has 0 days to fix it. That means it is unknown. So basically you will find a large number of vulnerability programs, or if you go to darknet, you will find people are paying like a huge amounts for 0 days, because these are vulnerabilities which are unknown to anyone, and which are not yet found by anyone. So if you heard of Struknet, constructs need, I guess. Yeah. So this was malicious computer worm, and it was basically famous for spreading viruses into nuclear systems, and it basically infected most of the Iranian nuclear systems because it made use of 20 plus 0 days, which were unknown vulnerabilities, and it is, since it is unknown, it is hard to find which vulnerability or which stuff they used in 0 days. So these are all info about 0 days actually. I hope it is clear. It is basically means the maintainer of that floor has 0 days to fix it.
Wow.
And 0 days vulnerabilities are not get listed here because let's say if I find vulnerability and if I don't tell anyone, that's the 0 day exploit, right? I can make use of exploit and I don't tell MITRE about that thing, and when it get released, there will be chaos everywhere.
Okay, great, Yatna. I hope Akshay that answers your question. And Yatna, just one more favor, like, can you just help us with like if there is any bug bounty programs, like where to connect, where do we get those from?
Sure. Okay. Yeah. So we call it as a responsibility disclosure program, which is also bug bounty program. So in responsible disclosure, a company or organization give you something to find the vulnerabilities. Either they will give you acknowledgement or either they will give you bug bounties. So in terms of bug bounties, it is actually monetary reward, which basically that organization will give you. So there are public bug bounty platforms like HackerOne. So this a public bug bounty program. There are also these are two popular bug bounty programs, and there is also ZeroDM, which is very interesting thing. So if you go to ZeroDM's Twitter page, they explain themselves as a let me show you that. Yeah, so they explain themselves as a we pay big bounty and not bug bounty. So they basically get a 0 day exploit and they sell it to federal governments or security researchers, and they basically pay you like a huge amount of money. So these are the bug bounty program, and there are also private bug bounty programs. So if you go to HackerOne, there are public bug bounty program listed. For example, Uber's bug bounty program, or let's go to Hacktivity. It is slow. Okay, activity or dictionary directory. So program directory will show you how many organizations have listed their onto HackerOne. So either they will give you points upon flop, or either give you either they will give you a money. Yeah, so popular bug bounty programs are like US Department of Defense, they pay you huge amount. Verizon Media, which is Yahoo's parent, mail.ru, AT&T, and there are like tons of sites here which pay you tons of money. And there is Hacktivity. If you want to learn about bug bounty program, I always refer this, and I read about people's write-up how they find actual security flaw. For example, this my Xbox support returned server side request forgery, like this organization takeover. We got $500 for this flaw. So if you can see reports like this, and you can learn many things from this. So check this Hacktivity page. So these are all public bug bounty program, And there are also private bug bounty program, which they don't tell you, because bug bounty is very competitive these days, and there are chances of increased noise. So they basically invite professional bug bounty hunters, and they just invite them and pay them a huge money. So apart from this public bug bounties, there are also publicly responsible disclosure program, like if you know Expedia, which is a flight company, I mean American online travel shipping shopping companies. So they also have programs. United Airlines also have bug bounty programs. So these are the just examples. So this is the info, Vishal. So if you want to check bug bounties, you should follow Twitter, because many of the bug bounty hunters follow Twitter and they share their write-ups, they share their processes. So it is very quick to learn.
Great. So yeah, that was like way informative for me, at least. Like, it was very informative, and I've tried to do some of this. Hope everyone was equally excited and they also learned few things from you. Thanks, Yadnya, for all your time.
Sure. Yeah, Vishal, sorry. Yeah. One last thing I just wanted to tell you all folks is, if you want, if you are using a Fedora machine, there is a yum module which will patch particular CVEs. So you can download this yum plugin repository, and if you put this something like the CVE, they can just basically patch, they can basically apply fixes related to that CVE, that Red Hat database. But just keep a note, it is a CVE record attached to Red Hat CV or advisories. So these are not from MITRE's account, these are from Red Hat's account, and these are fixes from Red Hat's public repositories. Yes, that was it. Yeah.